Well, good morning, Resolve Church family. Oh, thank you. It's really good to be here with you all. My name is Ryan Buss. I'm one of the pastors here at the Resolve Church, serving under our head pastor, Jesus. And I have the privilege of serving alongside really a team of amazing men and women who love Jesus. They love his word. They love his people. It's really an immense privilege to be serving as one of your pastors here. If you're new, I want to extend a very special welcome. I am personally excited that you're here, excited to see all that God is going to do here among you. Our desire is that you would really think of this as your church home, that spiritually this would become your family. Before we dive into our text this morning, I'd like to have a little bit of family business. If you've been coming around here for a little while, you'll notice that there's a whole bunch of us who are preaching each Sunday morning. We don't just have one guy who's preaching. And I just want to address that a little bit. This is not our normal MO. This is not our usual modus operandi. Normally, we have Pastor Dwayne. He's our lead preaching pastor who does most of the preaching on the Sundays. However, he's on sabbatical until December. And so now we have a rotation of preachers. And I want to kind of give some vision as to why we have a rotation. As I look across here, we have really three categories of people. Those who have been with us for a long time, and so those of us who are up here preaching as part of the rotation, we know you, you know us, we love you, you like us sometimes. You know, so it's not unusual. Maybe some of you have been around for a little bit, and you're starting to get to know us. You're like, okay, I think I recognize that guy. Or maybe not recognize me since I got my hair cut, you know, very recently. My hair was like this. So if you didn't recognize me, that's all right. If you're brand new, maybe you haven't gotten to see, you know, Pastor Dwayne preach, and you're seeing this rotation of men, you're up here like, what is going on? I can understand that might be just a little bit disorienting. Maybe a little bit sort of like, man, what is happening? There's a whole bunch of personalities, whole bunch of preaching styles and different levels of experience. This is a really pivotal time for us as a church. I want to really kind of share with you the vision for it. Really, it's to live out the vision that God has given us here at the Resolve Church. Pastor Dwayne would be the very first to say that this is not his church. This is actually God's church. And as God's church, we want to live out that vision. There's three ways that we really are having this played out in our preaching rotation, which have to do with the values as the Resolve Church. The first is leadership development. All the guys who are up here that are part of our church on staff or volunteer staff are being trained and developed in various capacities. The second reason is that we want to partner with other churches, other church plants, other pastors, especially those who are in our network, and especially with those who are in our network here in the city of San Diego. So occasionally, we'll have some other Acts 29 brothers come and preach for us, like we had with the Response Church. And the third value, really, in my opinion, the most important, is that it shows that God's word is the underlying thread throughout all of our church. Though we have various preaching styles and personalities, it is God's word that is consistent. And we at the Resolve Church firmly believe that it is God's word that does God's work. That God has committed himself to primarily ministering by his word. And so, man, we're all different in our preaching styles, but God's word is the same. And God wants to minister to you through his word. Sometimes you'll see these slides kind of going through at the very beginning of the service. And one has our values and vision statement, which is God's glory, the Jesus story in San Diego. Those are the values that we give ourselves to every single day. What we're seeking for us as a church as we continue to grow and live life together. Really, our church is far more than just a visionary and dynamic preacher. It's about God and his vision to glorify his son, Jesus. So, Resolve Church, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for sticking with us, for continuing to labor alongside of us in the ministry of the gospel here in San Diego. I firmly believe that God has big plans for this church, and I'm excited to have you be a part of that. So as we have different preachers up here, have different guys as our church in Acts 29, let's just enjoy all of the personalities that God has brought here, the people who are in staff, people who love you, love Jesus, are committed to you. All right. Without further ado, let's turn to our text. If you have your Bibles, let's go ahead and turn to Galatians chapter 3. Since the new year, we've been working through the book of Galatians. And we're almost at the halfway point of the book. We are in Galatians chapter 3, starting at verse 21 and going to verse 24. We'll also have it on the screen here. You can follow along. And here's what's going to happen. I'll read it. I'll declare it as God's word. We'll thank him for it together as a church. And then I'll pray over it. This is Galatians 3, verses 21 through 24. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin so that the promise by faith in Christ Jesus might be given to those who believe. Now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for allowing us to know you by your word, for revealing yourself to us in your holy scriptures. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that we can have true intimacy with you through your word. And God, I just want to ask and pray as we study your word, as we look at it together as a church family, would you really be stirring us by way of your Holy Spirit through your word? I pray that you would show us areas of our sin that we might come to you, Lord Jesus, for healing, to see our lives transformed again by the gospel. God, we pray for your blessing this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. The title for our sermon today is The Role of God's Law. God's law convicts us of sin. And I have three extremely simple points that I just want to take us through that the law convicts our sin of. The problem, the prison, and the pedagogue. We've been working through Galatians, as I've mentioned. We're in chapter 3. Now, chapter 3 really has everything to do with the role of God's law. In fact, we're in that little mini-series. We've divided the whole book of Galatians up into a little mini-series. We work through every single verse, every single word of the book. But we find it's easier to break it up into these little chunks so that you can have like little handholds as you work through the book. You don't kind of get lost and forget what's going on. So this particular miniseries, last week, this week, and next week, we'll be working and focusing specifically on the role of God's law in our lives. And really, the whole book of Galatians is pretty simple. Paul really seeks to address two very big questions that the early church was wrestling with and that we still today seek to answer, which is, how do I get right with God? How do I get right with God? And then how now shall I live? Those are the two big questions that are underlying the whole entire book of Galatians. And Paul has these arguments over and over and over again to emphasize that point. And so we're kind of at this melding of this crossing of how do I get right with God and how do I live. Last week, our church planting resident, Chris, preached the very first sermon on the role of God's law and how God's law points us to Jesus. Now, he had a really fun week because he got to talk about the promise of God, the eternal home and eternal approval of God. Oh, how sweet and glorious that is to our hearts, isn't it? To be reminded of the promise that we have in Christ that's been given to us. The whole purpose of the law is to point us to Jesus. What a fun week. I have the not so fun week, which is to really convict us of sin. That's not as fun. The whole role of God's law, one of the ways that God uses his word is to convict us of our sin. This is really the whole point of Galatians chapter 3. And in our text, Paul starts with a question, which is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Chris last week touched on this issue of the law and sin in verse 19. Paul asks this very natural question that begins to rise. If I am saved by grace, by faith, reaching out and grasping onto Jesus' righteousness, then what is going on with the law? Verse 19, why then the law? Paul straight up asks that. It was added because of transgression, really to increase sin. Then the next question that naturally arises in our minds is the contrary to the promises of God? Paul very quickly moves to say, certainly not. No way. No way, no way, no way. You see, the promise was given to Abraham first. It's amazing. What is added later doesn't nullify what he had already established. The two are not in opposition to each other. Numbers 23:19, God says this. God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should change his mind. See, it's in our nature as humans to lie, right? It's in our nature as humans to change our minds about things, to say one thing and do another, to kind of speak out both sides of our mouth. But this is not God's nature. This is not God's nature at all. There's no shadow of contradiction or change in him. So what is the purpose of the law? That's the whole question that we're seeking to answer in this little mini-series. I was a minister at SDSU and still am for many years, and there's a lot of big grassy green squares. I don't know if you guys have been to SDSU's campus, but they have a lot of grassy green squares that have to be seeded because grass doesn't actually really grow that naturally in San Diego. It has to be seeded. So every time it's seeded, put grass seed on there, they have these signs that get posted. Keep off the grass. Now, as I'm going to a meeting or to a class or a meeting with a student or something, and I see this sign, I'm walking by this grass, you know what I want to do? I want to walk on the grass, right? Like, it just stirs something in me that's like, man, I want to walk. It's not going to shave off that much time, but I sure as heck want to do it. I don't know why. It just instigates it in me. You see, this is kind of what God's law does. Keep off the grass sign is the law. It provokes sin. It instigates it. It actually reveals the sin that's there. So there's not a problem with the law. Not a problem with keep off the grass. They're trying to keep the grass nice. The problem is with me. I am the problem. My heart, my sin is the problem. God's law seeks to draw it out of us, to expose it. The Apostle Paul, the author of the book of Galatians, has this testimony. He actually gives his own testimony in the book of Romans about his own relationship with God's law and its ministry in his life. Romans chapter 7, verse 7. Paul says, what then shall we say? That the law is sin? By no means. Yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. For I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, you shall not covet. Coveting is just another word for jealousy or envy. Does this mean that Paul never had envy or jealousy or covetousness in his life until he read this law? By no means. All that the law did was to call sin what it is. Just sin. Not just, hey, that one time that you did that, Paul, that was sin. But actually began to increase it all the more. Here's Romans 7, verse 8. Paul goes on to say, but sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. Not just that one time, but now, man, I can't help but covet. I see it everywhere in my life. I don't know if you've ever maybe bought a new car or bought a used car or a car was given to you, but you have a car, you own it. You didn't own it before, and you're driving on the road, and what do you see? You see that same car everywhere, right? Before, you didn't really see it that much. I had this old car in college. It was a BMW 318i. I called it the old general. It was the best car in the world. I will argue that. And I, didn't own it before I went to college. My parents graciously gave it to me. And I didn't realize how many other BMW 300 series 1991 models there were on the roads in Phoenix until I got that car. I'm like, man, they're everywhere. This is cool. I think that's what the law does. Not only does it expose it, but now I'm seeing the sin everywhere in my life. Paul was coveting left and right. It's everywhere in my life. What is the result of this awareness of sin? It's death. Again, the Apostle Paul, continuing in Romans 7, he goes on to say, the very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me, and through it killed me. A side note here, Paul is making a very clear distinction between the law and sin. You notice, sin is in him. Okay, sin is inside of Paul. The law is from God. The law and the sin, two separate things. We need to keep that very, very important. For the law is not evil. The law is good. It comes from God, who is good and righteous and holy. His law is good and righteous and holy. It is sin in me. It is sin in me. It is sin in Paul. Paul says it killed him. Why? Because it brings with it the curse of disobedience. Earlier in the book of Galatians, Galatians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul says, quoting the Old Testament, he says, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them. There is a curse from God for disobedience. Becoming aware of our sin because of God's law, it actually kills us. Though we seek to keep it, try as hard as we can. The Apostle James in his letter, he says, whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point becomes accountable for all of it. You see, the promise, the law does actually promise life to the sinless person. The problem is that we are not sinless. The promise of life was actually really given to the only one who could and ever was sinless. Jesus. So no matter how good you are, at some point you will fail, and you have failed. And you'll be punished as though you failed at all of it. It's pass fail. It's not A minus, B plus, B minus, B. This is pass fail, and we've all failed. Paul goes on to say in verse 21, if the law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. The law was never intended to bring life. Obedience to the law was never intended to give us righteousness. It actually serves to show us how helpless we are, how powerless we are to stop sinning. It really shows us how deep this problem is in our life. It's so deep. We're so helpless to stop. It's foolish, utterly foolish to think that we can get into God's good graces by our good works. Relying, depending on our good works, actually kills us, brings the judgment of God upon us. And this isn't physical death. Paul, human author, was clearly physically alive when he wrote it. This is a spiritual death, really a separation. For in essence, that is what death is, separation. We're separated from God, from the source of life and joy and peace and comfort. We're now in this wasteland. Paul goes on to say, starting in verse 22, but the law imprisoned everything under sin. This is not just for the Jews who had the law of God. This is now for everyone. We are all under law. We inherently know good and evil. We know the consequences for breaking the law. No one exempt from this sweeping condemnation. And Paul uses the word scripture here synonymously with law. The whole of scripture certainly does convict us, because it has God's rules in it. The more we know of his word and read his word, the more aware we become of our sin. So what is our problem? We are the problem. It's in our hearts. Sin is deep in our hearts. It flows out of us. We need to see this problem. We really see it with our eyes. An even greater problem is that we're powerless to change it. We need to change. But we're powerless to stop. We need the only one who's able to actually change men's hearts, which is God, by his Holy Spirit. kind of on a practical level, it can become easy for us to see when we're breaking the law outwardly, right? Oh, I totally lied. Well, there it was. Easy to see. It's a lot harder to see that kind of lawlessness that's in our hearts. And really, it's out of the heart that sin flows. Jesus taught that over and over and over again. Sin isn't just what happens out here. Sin actually starts in here. And as Christians, we can tend to seek to obey God and his law kind of out of two wrong motivations. The fear of God's anger, maybe his punishment, or to win more favor, more blessing from God. That as I obey God more, he's going to give it back to me, right? Kind of like spiritual karma. The more good I do, the more God's going to bless me. Or, man, I don't want God to be angry, so I'm just going to like do my best to obey. Both of these are terrible motivations, and they will kill you. Spiritually, they will suck the life out of you. Which motivation are you working out of now? Which motivation, perhaps, do you see your relationship with God in? Fear of his anger? Or trying to get more of his blessing and his favor by doing good things? The end of verse 22, we see this beautiful promise, that the promise by faith in Christ is will be given to those who believe. The blessing of God comes by faith in Jesus. Thus, Jesus is the only one who's able to change us, to change our motivations for obedience. We don't need to fear the punishment or the anger of God because God already put out the punishment on Jesus. Jesus took that. He took the full anger, the full wrath of God for our sin upon the cross. God is so pleased with you now. You don't need to work to earn his approval or his favor. Jesus has won it for you, and he freely gives it eternally and infinitely. God desires that his people love him and they trust him. For only in God is real, actual life and hope and peace. He gives us his law so that we might know when we're loving other things or trusting other things other than him, that we might be brought into a renewed relationship with Jesus who sets us free and changes us. Well, sin not only exposes the problem, but it actually holds us prisoner to it. Which brings me to our second point, the prison. We see this here in verse 23. Paul says, now before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. This is an interesting verse here. Paul is teaching us that the law had a particular function with the nation of Israel, which was to hold them captive or prisoners until Christ would come on the scene. And Paul uses the word faith in this verse to describe Jesus, and as well as the way that God's people were designed to live in relationship with him, which is by faith. In terms of redemptive history, Paul's teaching us that the end of the law is Jesus. That the time of the law passes onto Jesus. However, there's another way for us to be able to understand this verse, which is namely of our own experience with God's law. And of Christ coming into our lives. As I mentioned before, when we become aware of our sin, we begin to see it everywhere in our lives. So much, actually, that we begin to feel like we're in a prison. I'm in chains. I can't get out. I'm trapped. In a very simple sense, the law acts kind of like a baby gate, keeping us from running into the kitchen to get our knives. I have a toddler, and she runs really, really fast. And baby gates, for whatever reason, just draws it out of her. You know, anywhere you put up a baby gate, she wants to go there. If you ever had kids and you had baby gates, you know that to be true. It'll just like, shoot, I want out, you know, or I want into that room, or whatever is going on. Like, I just want that. This is kind of like God's law. It brings it out, but it also protects us from even greater evil, even greater harm. But it's very much like a prison. Martin Luther, Reformation pastor, pastor and theologian, he has a very eloquent way of describing this. He says, the law imprisons people in sin, not only civilly, but also spiritually. That is to say, the law is also a spiritual prison and a real hell. When it reveals sin and threatens death and God's eternal wrath, we cannot avoid it or find any comfort. It is not in our power to shake off these terrors that the law stirs up in our conscience or any other anguish or bitterness of spirit. What are some ways that we might experience this? Terrors of our conscience, anguish, bitterness of spirit because of sin in our life, prisons. I'd like to take a few moments and talk about three particular sins that tend to be prisons for us. This is not exhaustive, and I know there's a lot of other sins out there, but these are three sins that are particularly rampant in our culture, and I want to give one warning. The first sin I want to address is sexual sin, including pornography, which is increasingly all over the place, and this not only affects men, but women as well, especially with erotic literature. Sexual sin, it's everywhere in music, in movies, in books. Sexual sin ruins marriages. We see lives that are littered with brokenness due to sexual sin. Sexual sin, it really traps our minds. It traps our bodies and our spirits. Sexual sin is very much a prison that you can begin to feel trapped in. The second one is anger, maybe, or bitterness. The two are very, very similar. Anger and bitterness. Though they might have different fruits in our life, they have the very same root. This is a very insidious sin because anger and bitterness can become like a cloak that we wrap ourselves in and we feel justified. When we're angry, when we're bitter, because we are in the place of judge, somehow I have determined that a person or a circumstance is not to my approval. I'm angry. I want justice for it. I'm hurt. People who are angry and bitter, they love it. It's like a drug. It's like an addiction. It can be hard to cast off, for to cast off anger and bitterness is to forgive. The antidote. You can feel trapped. The third is discontentment. Discontentment in life. This may not seem like a prison, but it's speaking from one who has been discontent many times in his own life. It very much is a prison. For you see, discontentment traps us where we are and not enjoying or having joy in the people or the place that God has put us. God has placed you here to enjoy the people and the place that he has you. And discontentment is a threefold sin. It is a sin of pride, saying, I actually know what is best for my life, and it's not going my way. How prideful are we to think that we know what's best in our life? I didn't create myself. God created me. God alone knows what's best for me, and his word has told me that he has my best in his mind, that he is working for my good. The second sin is not believing that God is actually good. For if he was good, he'd do exactly what I think should happen in my life. The job that I think I should have. The amount of money I think I should make. The place I think I should live. God is clearly not good, for I do not have those things. That's a lie. God is good. And the third sin is the sin that you don't actually believe, or you're not acting out of the belief, that God is sovereign. He has purposefully moved you here. placed you here, has the people around you that he does on purpose. Discontentment is rampant in our culture. Perhaps you're feeling discontent in your life today. Perhaps you are angry. You're bitter. Maybe you're trapped in some sexual sin. You just can't get out. I'm chained. Take a moment, please, and think about these things. As you're thinking about it, let me give one word of warning. If you're listening to this, you're like, sweet. Preacher man says I'm sinful. I don't feel that bad. I didn't go through those things. Awesome. I'm good. Beware. Beware. For that is the most dangerous of all. You do not know the darkness and the poison and the sickness that is in you. You must become aware of it. I pray that God's Spirit will show you that this morning. These are some of the terrors that we are in, the anguish of our souls. Who do you look to escape? Who are you looking to set you free from the prison? If you follow the news at all, you'll recall to mind that a couple weeks ago, two inmates from New York broke out of prison. I always find it amazing in today's culture that we can break out of prison. I've not been in prison. Maybe it's easy. I'm not really sure. But I just think of like the old Wild West, you know, where they like pull it down with the horses. Mythbusters, anyone see that episode? But they got out, and they had help from the inside to get out. But you know what's crazy? Is they still weren't free, were they? They had people hunting them to put them back in jail. Hey, I'm out of the physical prison, but you know what? You're still a convicted felon. You're still in prison, man. And one was killed because of it. The other got injured and is back in prison. This is our tendency, isn't it? When we begin to feel the weight of our sin, we see the chains wrapped around us. We begin to look to the inside for help, to escape. But friends, we cannot look to the inside. We cannot look to maybe political figures or friends or family members or whatever here to help us. We are all in the same real hell in prison with each other. We still won't get free. We need to look from the outside. This is a very dark state we are in. This is not a super awesome text to meditate on for a while. But I want to paint the backdrop very, very, very dark. Because the hope that is in Christ will shine so much brighter. It'll shine so magnificently that you will be drawn to it. If you ever go outside the city at night, the night is so dark, but you can see the stars so clearly. And friends, if you're feeling weighed down by sin or my yelling at you, that's okay. Because I want you guys to feel the weight before we feel the weight lifted. For Jesus comes and takes the weight and puts it on his shoulders, setting you free. We need to feel that weight. Jesus is the end of the law. Jesus is the one who sets us free from this prison. And our third point for today is the pedagogue. We see this in verse 24. Paul says, so then the law was our guardian until Christ came. This word guardian, as it's translated in the ESV, I think is a really good segue from our last point to this point. Although it doesn't necessarily have the connotation of a prison guard. Other words that the English uses to translate this word in the Greek are schoolmaster, tutor, mentor. The word in the Greek is the word pedagogos, which is actually where we get the word pedagogy. Familiar, right? Now, the singular noun is pedagogue. And this is not just a noun. This is actually a role that a occurred in the ancient Greek and Roman times. And I think I have a definition here that will really help us to understand this word guardian and what is going on in the nuance of the law and our relationship with it. The pedagogue was a guardian, a guide of boys. Among the Greeks and the Romans, the name was applied to trustworthy slaves who were charged with the duty of supervising the life and morals of boys belonging to the better class. The boys were not so much as allowed to step out of the house without them before arriving at the age of manhood. The culture of the first century Rome, ancient Greeks, the role of the pedagogue here was multifaceted. They supervised the daily life of their charge. They escorted them to school. They even held their school materials at times. They taught them the morals and the family values that they were growing up in. They took care of them when they were sick, and they chaperoned them around town. They couldn't even leave their home without this pedagogue going with them. Sort of like a super glorified nanny, in a way. Now, this only happened until the boys reached the age of maturity, which is very similar to today, 17 or 18. Now, when they were mature and reached this age, the pedagogue was no longer their supervisor, but does this mean that they actually rejected the morals and the values that they grew up in? No, actually, the reason why that age was so important is because oftentimes they had internalized the values of their family, the morals of their family, so much so that they didn't need a supervisor. And I don't know if it's, you know, Comic-Con season or what, here in the city, but when I was thinking about this role of the pedagogue, Batman came to mind. Actually, more specifically, Alfred the Butler came to mind. I don't know if any of you watch the TV show Gotham, but my wife and I really like that TV show. Gotham is a TV show that really focuses on the young adolescent Bruce Wayne, right after his parents are killed, and kind of, you know, all of the origin stories of the Penguin and the Riddler, the Joker, and so on. And really, much of the show focuses on this relationship between Bruce and Alfred. And Alfred is in charge of Bruce. He supervises Bruce's daily life. He teaches him the morals and the values of what it is to be a Wayne. You're a Wayne man. He teaches him how to fight and even protects him when people come in to try and kidnap him. Alfred was really acting in many ways like the ancient Greek and Roman pedagogues of supervision, moral teaching, and chaperoning. But here's the deal. The pedagogue, Alfred, was not their parents. The pedagogue were not the parents of the boys. The boys were actually sons of their parents. Their identity was not found in the pedagogue. It was found in being a member of the family. So too it is with us. You see, our identity, our relationship is not with the law. Our identity, our base identity, is as a created son or daughter of God. We were created to be in relationship with God. That's our base identity. But sin, as I've been mentioning, comes in and creates a separation between us and God. It separates us. We're not in this kind of relationship that we were designed and created to be in. God gives us this law so that we might know it and that we might run to Him for mercy, for restoration. The law actually causes us to run to Christ in humility and trust. We come to Him in need, trusting His provision, His life for our life. And when we do this, this renews and restores the relationship with God that we are created for all along. The law then passes from being our guardian to Jesus is our guardian. Our life is now able to be lived in intimacy with Christ, in humility, trusting Him, in this dependent and sweet relationship with Jesus. Now, how does the law teach us? How does it act maybe as a pedagogue or a schoolmaster, as the old KJV but translated. Another Reformation pastor, John Calvin, has a really good way of kind of succinctly helping us understand how the law could teach us, ultimately teaching us toward Christ. He says, in the imposing services of the Mosaic ritual, everything that was presented to the eye bore an impress of Christ. The law, in short, was nothing else than an immense variety of exercises in which the worshipers were led by the hand to Christ. When we read the scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament, when we read the scriptures, we are led by the hand to Jesus because, friends, we need to be led. We need to be led on our own. We keep kicking against it. We need to be led to Christ. Also, in God's word, we see again how I was mentioning we are designed to live in a humble and dependent relationship with God. God desires that we love him, that we trust him. The law shows us how over and over and over again we turn to other things to be our masters. We trust in other things, the created things. Our hearts are prone to wander. We find happiness in all other things which will fail, which will drain us, which will cause us anxiety, depression. How are we to live? The end of verse 24 is beautiful. Paul says, in order that we might be justified by faith, we need to turn to Jesus. How do we do this? We turn to him in faith. And what is faith? What is faith? Faith is a kind of giving up. Faith is kind of like a surrendering, saying, God, I cannot do this. I cannot do this. Help me. Jesus, I am trapped. Break these chains. Save me, Jesus. It's a surrendering. And when we surrender and when we give up and run and come to Jesus, oh, we get the sweet promise of life. He does actually break those chains. He does actually save us from these prisons. He does change our hearts. So now we desire to obey God out of gratitude and not obligation. We can live in humility knowing that the God of the universe loves me. He actually loves me. He has my best interest in heart. We surrender our pride, thinking that we know what is best for our life, and we turn to the one who created us, who knows what is best, and is working, always working, for our good. It's a surrendering, seeking to be performing for God to get his approval or just assuage his anger. Faith is a letting go of my pathetic righteousness in order to grasp the eternal, the rich, and the powerful righteousness of Christ. When we reach out in faith to Jesus, we receive that justification, that declared rightness with God, the promise of eternal life and approval, like we focused on last week, the pardon of God, we get the provision of God. And there's another promise, which we've touched on so far in the book of Galatians, and we'll focus on. And this is the sweet promise of God's Holy Spirit. He's also called the Paraclete. Our pedagogue passes to the Paraclete. The law passes to the Spirit. The Spirit is called the Comforter. And it's only in God's Spirit can we find actual and true comfort in our life. The law is a terrible comforter, isn't it? All it does is show you how bad you are. That's all it does. The Spirit says, yes, you are, but Jesus is so good. And Jesus loves you, not on what you've done, but on his performance for you. And we'll touch more on this Spirit in chapter 5. It's coming up. So good. This is a little teaser. However, as Christians, we still have the tendency to look to ourselves and to our performance to make us right. You know, to make us feel like we're okay with God. Friends, let us surrender this to God. We have the freedom to do our best, and when we fail, we come to Christ for mercy, for renewal. I'd like to conclude by reading from The Valley of Vision, which is a collection of Puritan devotions and prayers. I've done this before, and I really like it. I think that the Puritans had a very eloquent and heartfelt way of describing God's ministry in our life. So, don't be weirded out by this, but I'd like you to close your eyes. Okay? This is not weird, I promise. And just as I read this, let this prayer be yours this morning. O righteous and holy Sovereign, save me from myself, from the artifices and deceits of sin, from the treachery of my perverse nature, from denying your charge against my offenses, from a life of continual rebellion against you, from wrong principles, views, and ends, for I know that all my thoughts, affections, desires, and pursuits are alienated from you. I have acted as if I hated you, although you are love itself. Have contrived to tempt you to the uttermost, to wear out your patience, have lived evilly in word and action. Had I been a prince, I would long ago have crushed such a rebel. Had I been a father, I would long since have rejected my child. O Father of my spirit, King of my life, cast me not into destruction. Drive me not from your presence, but wound my heart that it may be healed. Break it that your own hand may make it whole. Friends, this is our desire. That God would crush us, that he would remake us in Christ. That we would see our sin, that we might see Jesus having taken our sin. We can respond in gratitude and thanksgiving for his love to us. We're going to prepare to respond in a time of communion. I'd like to quickly summarize all that we've looked at. This week we've taken a look at how God's law convicts us of our sin. We see the problem that we have, which is that we are sinful. God's law is not sinful, it simply exposes it. We see that the law is like a prison. It holds us trapped in sin. We need to turn to the outside, to Jesus, to help us get free, and he does actually set you free. We see that the law was a pedagogue, was a guardian until Christ would come. And when we come to Christ and he comes into our life, he gives you his spirit, who is now teaching you and guiding you and comforting you. Bring real comfort, real, actual guidance in life. When we come to the table, we see Jesus' body broken on the cross with the bread broken. See, Jesus, he took the punishment for our sin, that we would never experience the anger of God. Instead, we would only ever have his approval, his pleasure always. We don't ever need to fear God's anger. Jesus performed perfectly, lived a sinless life, because I cannot. His life for my life. We see Jesus' blood spilled on the cross with the wine or the juice. We see the love that ran down to seek you out, that he would not leave you in this state, but he would give you a new spirit, a new heart, a new home, a new life, one that's all for God's glory. So as you come this morning, I would just ask that you would do some business with God. Just ask him where you're at. God promises by his Spirit to show us any unclean way in us and to lead us in the everlasting way. And if you're not yet a believer, I would ask that you remain seated. This is a time just for God and his people. But if you're feeling God stirring in you, you're being like, oh man, yeah, that's me, I need Jesus. I'll be here at the front. You can pray with me. I'd love to talk with you more. If you need prayer for anything, I'll be here in the front. Anything at all. If you're prepared to give, we have our giving boxes here at the front and in the back. This is a time that you can go get your kids and bring them. So let me pray as we enter into a time of reflection and response.